The primary reasons being childcare, spouse relocation, and pregnancy. However, the actual career derailers are the lack of support systems, lack of flexi working options, and long working hours. The survey also reveals that career breaks are largely between 1 to 2 years and 3 to 5 years, which indicates that most women are able to come back after the initial nursing period of their kids or when they start going to school. So we have here our distinguished panelists who have been there and done that. So Blaine Peterson, who is the Vice President Technology at Goldman Sachs, a mother of two, she has been through a global relocation from New York to Bangalore in 2010. Welcome, Blaine. Saundarya Rajesh, the founder president of AVTAR Career Creators and Flexi Careers India, mother of two and wife to a busy professional. Her consulting firm works with over 24,000 managers to create flexible and second career opportunities for women professionals. Welcome, Saundarya. So welcome back, Saundarya. Subhashini Sriram, who is the VP HR Consulting at Northern Trust. She is also a chairperson of Women and Leadership Business Resource Council of India, which focuses on diversity and inclusion initiatives. Again, mother of two, she took a break midway in her career for pursuing her higher studies. Welcome, Subhashini. And finally, Dr. Vijayalakshmi. She is a faculty of Organizational Behavior and Human Resources with the Department of Management Studies at IIT Madras. She is involved in research projects on positive organizational behavior, workplace humor, and using neuro-linguistic programming for career advancement. Welcome, Vijayalakshmi. Viji, in short. So, we just went over the main causes and the trends of career breaks. The graphs that Saundarya had shown earlier in her slides. So let's just get started with our panel discussion. So my first question to Subhashini, do you think there has been any change in the trend in the past 5 years of your experience as a HR professional?
I do think, am I audible?
Yeah,
okay, great. I do think, you know, there has been a slight change, while the predominant reasons remain the same, which is childcare and handling, you know, many other things. But, you know, the latest trend has also been to kind of handle elder care. I think that's something which seemed to have creeped in, interestingly. And also, some of the women who are probably after their 10 to 15 years of career as well, you know, looking at getting either back for upskilling or looking at, you know, going the entrepreneur way. I think those are, you know, the recent trends, I must say, from what we would have seen otherwise in the past.
So, Saundarya, do you believe there is a perfect time to take a break?
I only can, you know, echo what Kritika said this morning. She said, is there a perfect time to have a baby? No. Is there a perfect time to determine when you want to take that break? I don't think there is. I think things just come together in a way that sort of pushes you to take that break. Yeah. So, but if you look at the cost benefit, you know, of when is it better to take a break, you know, there are equal numbers of votes on either side. So there's one group that says it's better to take the break when you're still young because you don't have too much to lose. You can come back and, you know, still catch up on your career. And there's the next group which says that it's better to have like really been there, done that, and then take the break, because that means you'd have already established, you know, your credibility in the market. So there are both these groups. There is no right or wrong. Break is a break, and I guess we all have to just manage, you know, how we can do it. So,
Vijayalakshmi, what is your take on the mentor effect? Do you think they can make or break a person's career?
Lot of researchers have, so I bring in the research aspect because I'm an academician. So a lot of researchers have shown that organizations which found mentoring programs organically, which means it develops by itself and it's not by HR system, a more higher probability that people, you know, actually the research shows that women would reach the number one or two position if they find mentoring, if the mentoring programs are done by themselves, actually. And nothing is better than woman-to-woman mentoring. So definitely there is a lot of impact. Saundarya has also mentioned earlier, mentoring is extremely important.
Subhashini, more often than not, employees are not aware of the various policies that are available within the organization. So could you please throw light on some general flexible working options that are available in the organization today?
Right. I think we have come a long way from where we started, I must say, or 15 or 20 years back, you know, in looking into the policy changes. Predominantly, there has been awareness, as Saundarya kind of mentioned there, and because of which there has been influence in the policies as well. Policies which have been framed, definitely have thought through some of the difficulties, especially when we want to have gender diversity in our organization for various reasons. So most of the organizations today frame policies, you know, looking into what is a trend that employees are getting attracted and what are the issues that they're coming up with. Also to be equalizers or differentiators in the market to ensure that you're not losing out your diverse candidates, you know, if the market has something to offer, which is actually excellent, which is very good. I think technology, connection, awareness, everything has helped on it. But what is more important that I have seen in organizations that I've worked is, while policies are in existence, generally managers or, you know, employees are not very much aware of the intricacies of those. Sometimes policies are not available, but it's okay for the partner or the employee to go out and talk about an exception, because exception cases are not covered under policies. But exceptions do happen, and more often than not, good employees are definitely wanted in the industry, and people do want to retain them. So if there is a possibility of tweaking some of the policies or creating an exception, organizations are pretty much open about it. It's only the employee who is moving out has to come out and talk about it and not make an assumption. It is not within my policy framework, and hence I can't kind of go and ask about it. 90% of the time, if you ask, you will get it as well.
So that was my follow-up question. What should one do to challenge employee unfriendly policies?
Right. As I said, one, definitely more and more women partners, women employees coming and talking about it helps. Interesting to see that not just women, in today's scenario where both men and women are working, there are men as well who come and ask us for, you know, time offs, time adjustments, working from home, part-time options and things like that. You know, few in number, but that's a trend that we see, and that's very healthy, I must say. What is important for employees is to understand, one, as much as you contribute, to go out and talk to the right people and ask for those exceptions. I think it's a mindset change that we need to go through as well, to go back and say that, I know we don't have a policy like this, but this is my current scenario. I would like to continue in the organization. What are the best options? And also look at it more not from a command or demand perspective, but working along with the organization to fulfill the requirement, you know, with a mutual consensus. I think that goes a great way, I must say.
Blaine, this question goes to you. One thing that every employee dreads or is apprehensive about is conversation with the manager. So even unsure of what the manager would react, they go into a defensive mode and don't even come up to ask. So what do you think, or how do you think one should have an ideal conversation with the manager to on a career break?
So it's like how to approach that conversation? Right, so I think, you know, you don't want to go into that kind of conversation unprepared, right? You don't want to, that's not the kind of conversation where you want to be winging it, right? So you want to really come, you know, if you're the employee and you want to talk to your manager about that, you want to have a plan, and not just your plan for your break, but you really want to appear like you have, you know, you've thought it out, you've considered different options, and you've got a plan, and you should also have a plan for that conversation, right? What are the different things that could happen? Is, you know, maybe option one is that everything is great and the manager is very supportive and you come up with a plan and you work on the next steps, but maybe it's not going to go that way. So you really should go into that kind of conversation fully prepared and thinking about the different ways that conversation could go, but also come in very much with a plan of how you're going to manage your career.
So So I was talking to Viji this morning and we were also discussing on the importance of conversation with the team members, mm-hmm. which is as important as conversation with the manager. Would you want to throw some light on that?
So this would come before the break that you want to take. Usually what happens is you're in a hurry to leave. So my suggestion would be to spend quality time with your team members, trying to close up things with them. I think I'm sure all of us do that, but some of us miss out on informing them, okay, this is what I'm going to do. So 6 months I'm going to go out, I'll be doing this, hopefully I'll be coming back after 6 months. This kind of closing up is extremely important before taking a break with the team members.
Can I share one point on that I think also focus on?
Okay. I think this goes back to the previous session, and this is one of those things where if you need support from your team members, if you're working on this, the time to build that support is not the time when you're going on a break, right? You should be building that network, and you should be sort of creating that support system, and you should have been doing it all along. So that then when you are in a situation where you need support and you need backup, it's not even a question. They're going to be there for you, and they're going to be very glad when you come back, and we'll help you with that.
So to the audience, we will have a Q&A at the end of the discussion, but please feel free to raise any questions in the middle of the session. So during a break, and this is to Viji, we see a lot of people switching from technical to management careers. So a lot of people go in for higher studies to achieve this. So what is your take on higher studies? Are the negative and the positive impacts of taking up higher studies to switch careers?
Earlier, technical careers used to be very independent, as in women, they have the innate ability to collaborate and communicate with people. And in technical careers earlier, not now, things are changing right now. It used to be a very isolated, you know, you're an island of excellence. You don't really communicate with the other person. But definitely the trend has changed. And that was the reason why women started shifting from technical to management careers, because management careers offered that flexibility too. So in order to shift the profile from technical to management, they undertook higher studies. For example, I have a friend who is joined for PhD right now with me. So she's working in Ford, but she's taken a break and now she's doing PhD. Why? She just wants the headspace to think and really, you know, decide what she wants in the next 2-3 years.
So over to you, Blaine, again. So how important do you think is it to stay up to date on the latest trends? And how do you think one can achieve this?
So you mean like while you're on a break, if you're...
Right.
I think it's very important. I think, you know, you don't know, especially if your break is of the flavor that you've left a firm and you're not necessarily coming back. So maybe you're going away and taking a sabbatical and are planning on coming back. Coming back to the same firm, but it also may be the case that you've resigned your position and are not sure what's coming back. In which case, you definitely want to stay up to speed. And you know that doesn't mean that you need to be writing code every day or doing your same function while you're away. But I think it really helps to just stay in touch. And I think actually more important than staying up to speed technically is staying in touch with your network and kind of not falling off the edge of the world for a few months and then suddenly showing back up, you know, saying, here I am, right?
So anything on the freelancing opportunities?
So I did that. So before I worked for Goldman Sachs, I previously worked for a telecom firm in New Jersey that I won't name. But I was part of a downsizing there. I was laid off, and I was laid off for about 9 months. And I actually started doing some freelance work and it really wasn't about earning money at that point, because my husband was earning money and we didn't have a family and it was fine, but I really just didn't want to have that huge gap on my resume. I really wanted to stay in touch and kind of be able to say I'd been doing something. I also wanted to stay sort of mentally focused as well.
Like, just sort of like flexibility of doing things when you also...
Exactly, and I wanted to stay sharp. So.
And this to Subhashini or Saundarya. So you have been there, done that. So tell us some of your experience of what you went through when you decided to go in for a break and come back again.
Okay. I actually must do a little bit of a rewind for me to share this. I basically started my career off with Citibank in the year 1990. So that reveals how old I am and what kind of dinosaurus, you know, world I'm going to talk about. So was working with Citi for about 3 years, then got married in the middle, which is a good thing, I'm still married. Then had a baby, which was a good thing too. But then, you know, what typically happened was after the baby, I found it really difficult to manage both the home and the office front. I mean, Citibank back in those days was this absolute fun place to, you know, work in. I mean, you really enjoyed it. People were really doing very well. You had opportunities, you know, to grow and everything. But somehow, you know, because of the fact that I did not have proper support systems at home, and the fact that, you know, forget my mother-in-law, even my mother was very uncomfortable about, you know, me putting the baby in a creche. I, you know, was talking about putting him in a daycare center or a creche, but I think she heard it as orphanage. So she thought, you know, I'm going to completely abandon the child and that's it. So, you know, to actually tell someone that, you know, I'm not going to sort of completely remove him from my life and so on was very difficult. So I did take that break. And for me, the break sort of really extended because whenever I would go for an interview and I would, you know, say that I've taken a break and come back, people would focus completely on the break and not on the skills that I had. And even if I got past that and, you know, there was an offer made, I would say that I would prefer to work flexibly or part-time initially before ramping back full-time. And that was a total deal breaker. So for 6 years, this thing went on till in 1990, so for 3 years. So in 1996, I decided that I have to do something, otherwise I was going crazy. More importantly, I was driving everybody at home crazy. So they said, please go and do something. So I got into teaching. So I taught at this college called MOP Vaishnav College in Chennai. And I taught there for about close to about 4 years. And that was when, you know, when I started interacting with the women students, it really came upon me as to how women plan their careers so differently from men. There's always, you know, this focus that what will happen when I get married? What will happen when I get a baby? So you don't look at your skills and say, what am I going to do with these skills? What will happen when I upgrade my skills? Or what will happen when I dream big or think big? No. So there is something like, you know, something that anchors you, which is good, which is really good. But then there's, it also acts as a big deterrent. Because then you're not rising up to your full potential at all. And like, you know, Kritika said this morning, if you want it all, then you really have to sort of prioritize ruthlessly of what your market worth is because you've taken a break. Whose mistake is it? I mean, if you're having a clockwork of career wherein you're not able to participate on an equal footing, that's not the woman's mistake, isn't it? So this was my short or long sort of background. So I'm going to pass it on to Subhashini.
Thank you. I think a slightly different experience for me. Kind of took a semi-break, I must say, for my education. And, you know, want to share some tips maybe which helped me and I hope that it will help others. This was, you know, when I was heading HR, you know, in an organization called Telelogic, which is IBM currently, which is taken over by IBM. Louder? Okay, great. Is it better? Okay, great. Thanks. So this was when I was heading HR for a company called Telelogic, which is when I realized I need to go back to B school and kind of upskill myself. Primarily to understand financial management, reading a balance sheet, and so on and so forth. You know, I think a little preparation did help me. When I say a little preparation, what helps sometimes is that heading HR, you know, going part-time and doing an IIM program is definitely not a possibility, right? So even if I wanted to, I think the organization would have suffered because we were a growing organization at that point in time. So what I kind of conceived even before I went to the management was to look at what could be the opportunity for me to work as a part-time HR consultant with them as I do my 9-month executive program with IIM, which is more a Saturday-Sunday program and with intervals, full-time, you know, 15-day kind of a program schedule. So I picked something like that, which also required us to kind of, you know, do our exams, get our grades, and so on and so forth. With my 3-year-old kid, and the you know HR head opportunity, And this, it was not possible. I kind of knew the risks that I was taking, but I was pretty sure that I think that's something that I have to do it at that point in time. So I went with a proposal to the management looking at what are the current need in the HR space, which was more, you know, HR information system, you know, a lot of process and systems which were the need at that point in time, which I was not able to completely dedicate my time as the head of HR. So I said that you could kind of go ahead and hire somebody in the HR head position, but I would kind of move into a consulting, and these are the areas that I think I can contribute, you know, in that way I would have a continuity with the organization as well, which helped at that point of time. It was a mutual, requirement at that point of time. People were able to appreciate that, and I did take a cut on my salary. I did, move out and had somebody else who kind of took over the role from me. But I was able to help the person, and I was also able to kind of pursue what I wanted with IIM Bangalore and kind of close it out. But when I came out was the issue, because I can't get back to the same position where somebody else has been hired. But I was, I must say, that lucky enough to get the opportunity that I wanted, you know, going out and looking for that. That was kind of a, that kind of helped me to continue with a lesser scale, in a lesser scale, not in the same span, but continue with, in a marginal career break, I must say. So sometimes it helps to kind of you yourself go prepared as to what do you think can be your value add to the organization, so that instead of just allowing your manager to think on your behalf or the organization think on your behalf, you kind of think about the space, the pain areas, and where you can add value, and go with that as an input, which sometimes helps. But again, you know, it depends on the environment. The second, of course, was more, a break for my second kid. As Saundarya says, you have excellent support structure, but sometimes as mothers, we always feel that you want to be near them, you don't want to put them in few weeks' time into a crash, so on and so forth. But what helped me was all that we spoke about at this point in time. One, being, prepared, staying connected, having a network not just with the professional group, but also with others who would help you on your support when you want to get back. You know, the working mothers, if you are somebody who is a first-time working mother, then you want somebody to kind of bounce your thoughts about how did you manage, how did you get back, what do you do, and kind of things. I think that's extremely important. That helps you a lot. During the break as well, I must say that, as Blaine said, stayed completely connected. I was going to a local college very regularly, taking their management program. I was also connected with, through my network, one of the consulting agency, which gave me some consulting opportunity, freelance kind of, which I was, kind of doing, and I was keeping myself completely updated so that the resume doesn't appear that there is a break in your professional competency, you know, more than, you know, anything else. So I think you need to constantly come up with innovative thinking as what would fit you, be prepared, stay connected with people who can actually help you, you know, like, you know, moving those to become, to make yourself ally with certain people who would be able to help you and support you. I think everything is needed. All that has helped.
And one more important thing is staying positive during a break.
Right.
More often we are too much bugged by the guilt conscious of taking a break. So
Absolutely.
How do we overcome that?
I think that's a very beautiful point, I must say, important point. As you take a break, I think as a preparation before you take a break, it's important to kind of set the expectations for your own self. Right? And be very clear about what you're entering into. And I really liked Saundarya's point that look at what are the things you have really not done. You have missed in your, because you're just running between profession and personal life and so many expectations around you. And enjoy your stay, but also stay connected. I think that is extremely important. Only if you stay positive would you be able to really look at things as to what you really need and approach the right resources to the right things. So it's extremely important. You really don't get that time afterwards to stay positive and look at what are some of the things that you have not done before. You need to continue to do that. Absolutely.
So moving over to the transition from during a break or to trying to find a suitable role. So Blaine, as a manager, would you hire a second career woman? We have some interesting studies here. We hire we have women and men responding, and we found that 4% of women who said that they will not hire a second career woman, which is very surprising, wherein all the men said they were eager to hire the second career women. So what are your thoughts on this?
Yeah, I'm not going to try to analyze that statistic. I think it's very strange. But you know, obviously, I would. And you know, at Goldman, we actually have what we call a returnship program, which I think started in the U.S. We've kicked it off here in India, where we actually, you know, create an internship for women that are returning to the workforce after a few years off, sort of give them all that same benefit and support and training that we do for our campus hires, which is very successful, but sort of come up with a program for women that are returning to the workplace after a break. And it starts with, I think, an 8 or 12 week internship with very low commitment on both sides, but with the expectation that they will do well and will continue on in a career. In fact, we had a Saturday hiring session, or a super day, but basically a recruiting session where we were doing interviews. And I have to say, we do a lot of interviews, and I do a lot of interviews, and these were really interesting, smart women that had so much to bring to the table. They had so much, they had so many interesting stories to tell. And you could tell, though, they were very nervous. Like, they all kind of started off with this incredibly long apology for why they had taken a break. And I kind of feel like, we know you took a break. That's why you're here today. Like, we want to get past that. We want to talk about what you can bring now. And you know, I think one thing we talked about in one of our sessions where we, you know, the prep sessions for this is there's such a huge war for talent right now. You can't afford to just disregard an entire segment of the workforce and a huge potential pool of talent that could fill those positions. I know personally I've been trying to fill some spots for months. So
this is kind of a relatively new concept in the industry. So my question to Viji, so do you think such second career innings require change of mind from the employee and the employer's perspective?
Very, very easy answer, both. So from the employer's side, they really need to overcome stereotypes. So when women take a break, employees perceive that to be lack of commitment, or they're not very responsible, they're not very serious about the work. That mindset needs to change. I don't know if it's changed now. So that's from the employer's side. From the employee's side, Blaine actually took my point. Most of us are very apologetic. So I remember when I left TCS for my for preparing for my marriage, I had to do all the preparations. Going back, I had to really explain the six-month gap. It was seen as a cardinal sin. You're taking a break for marriage, you know, that kind of attitude the employer had. And I was apologetic, actually. So there was no need to be. And so from the working mother perspective, what happens is you get a different perspective. For example, you're really grounded in reality. When you become a mother, you know the difference between urgent and critical. And you can bring all those best practices into workforce when you're starting to work again. So mindset needs to be both from the employee and the employee side.
I think that's a very good point. Learning on the career is one thing, but being a mother and learning is again a very important thing. We learn so many things when we are on a break, and that makes us a much matured person there. So,
Sruthi, I just want to add to what Viji was mentioning about the employer's perspective. Very honestly, having worked in the space and having represented a lot of women to organizations, I would say that the whole sensitization of organizations around second careers, that is a very recent phenomenon. That's been happening for not more than at most about 3 to 4 years. And I would say that it's companies like Goldman, it's companies like Unilever, it's companies like Microsoft, like GE, who are actually sort of defining, you know, what can be done in this space. And, you know, from an employer's perspective, just to add to what you were mentioning, Viji, if you go to an average manager, someone who's a hiring manager, and you give him 10 CVs, and you ask him to shortlist, the instinct is to shortlist people with uninterrupted careers. The instinct is to immediately sift out the people who've had breaks in careers. So that mindset is very strongly entrenched, you know, in the minds of hiring managers. So one of the things we do, you know, with organizations that we work with is, how do you actually look beyond the break? How do you look at the skill sets of the person and how do you assess them for what they are? And the break is just incidental. Have they kept themselves? Like, I really liked what, you know, Subhashini just mentioned about the fact that she kept herself relevant even while in that break, you know, doing small projects, taking up freelancing assignments, which is what Blaine also echoed. So are you doing that? And if you've done that and you've not been with a formal organization for 6 months, 1 year, 2 years, 4 years, it's irrelevant. But that is something that I would say is, you know, very strongly still there. And a lot of work needs to get done. Sessions like this, I think, are very essential in every conference, you know, to actually tell people that they have to move beyond merely looking at it as a break. You know, she's like the Scarlet Woman. She's taken a break. So, you know, then everything else sort of becomes irrelevant then. Yeah.
Very valid point. While we have a sensitization program for the managers, the actual filter or the entry point is the recruiters. So passing through them, the first level of filter, I think it's a very big task and we need to sensitize people even at the grassroots level. So how do you think one should market oneself and fill in the resume gaps?
Straight away, I think I would just take a page out of what Subhashini mentioned. You know, how do you stay relevant in your gap? Now, I was talking about this even yesterday. One thing is when you are at a stage in career when you're relatively still younger, you're still, you know, in the early stages of your career, specifically like this track, early career track. So during that time, what people look for is if you've shown consistency in going after a particular field or a subject. For instance, if you are in information security, have you done that, you know, repeatedly in different organizations or even while you are on a break? If you're on a break, what prevents you from writing a paper for a journal? You can do that, which means that you still are, you know, accessing information. You might probably not be working for a company doing it. But what prevents you from, you know, collaborating with, say, an institute like, you know, IIT Madras and, you know, saying, I offer my services in writing a paper or doing a research. That shows very, very positively on your resume. So when somebody asks you a question, you might not have worked in information security at that point of time, but if they ask you details about it, you'll be able to answer. That is for the early career track. When women take breaks in the mid or in the late, you know, stages of their career, it's all about what kind of a persona they have built. Now, I was talking about, you know, this lady who was the CMO of PepsiCo. Her name is Punita Lal. She took a 1 year break in career after she was, you know, one of the heads of businesses for J. Walter Thompson, working on the Coke account. So she's someone who's worked for both Coke and Pepsi. And it's completely unbelievable in a real life scenario kind of thing. So she was there, then she took a break to pursue her passion, which was pottery. So, you know, I mean, how does pottery even relate to what you do at your work? But when she got a call from a headhunter and when they spoke to her about the break, she said, I'm just pursuing my passion. If you want to know how good I am at my job, ask me any kind of question relating to my job and watch me perform at work. And that sort of completely closed any doubts that people might have. So
I think that's an upcoming trend, right? A lot of women are turning their temporary breaks into permanent ones and going the entrepreneurial way. Right. I think that's an upcoming trend.
Absolutely.
Nowadays.
Absolutely.
Right. Just want to add, you know, a small piece to this. You know, while you stay relevant, it also helps you to build your own confidence when you attend the interview to tell them very clearly that this is the value add that you can bring in. From an employer perspective, what I've noticed is managers take you much more seriously if you are confident about what value add. So I think when you get back, you should more focus on what is the value add that you bring to the table than being apologetic about that you have taken a break. I think confidence and the seriousness that you bring to the table kind of turns around the table many a times. And people then look at you not as a person probably who has taken a break. So concentrating more on what you've done and papers, you know, whatever you would have done, focusing your interview conversations to that kind of helps as well, you know, in building your own confidence.
And so when you come back to work, I think support system is the key factor to come back into business. So what are your thoughts on support system? Open to any of you.
I think, you know, we all kind of live by that, you know, more than my husband or anybody else. I think my mates are important. I need to confess that. I'm sure this recorded version sometime would get to my husband's notice. But I think you definitely need to have your support structure. And you kind of need to think through from your family perspective what fits you. A support structure can be a crèche arrangement for somebody. A support structure needs to probably have a maid arrangement for somebody. A support structure could be your in-laws. But when you are asking for something, you have to be willing to give as well. When you bring in your family into picture, obviously they'll have a bigger say in many things, and you need to kind of accept that that's a reality, and hence you need to kind of go with that. But what is important is also, as I said, as you build your network in the professional environment, build your network in the personal space as well, with people who have done that, who have experienced that, who are very resourceful and who can help you kind of in these areas. I think that's extremely important. And you kind of start preparing much before you get back to the, you know, work. You kind of start at least 5 months, 6 months, train it out so that you don't have the pressure and think about it even when you get back to work and reflect that in your performance so that your managers also feel this is exactly the reason I didn't want to take somebody, you know, who has taken a break. I think you kind of need to prepare yourself thoroughly for that.
So to add one thing to that, I think that for me what was really helpful, and I'm actually there thinking less, you know, specifically about when I came back from maternity leave, but it was two things. One was having someone in my personal life who was completely detached from my work that was very supportive and could just listen to me and, you know, complain or whatever. But the other was having somebody at the office that also kind of knew what I was going through and had experienced the same thing. Another thing we do at Goldman is we have sort of maternity mentors. So when I came back, I actually had someone that had also recently come back that I could ask questions to. And I actually found that kind of became a little network too. About a year later, there was, it actually has nothing to do with rank or position. You know, it's more just people that have been through that same thing. About a year after I came back, I actually found a managing director in the firm was coming to me to ask questions about coming back from maternity leave because she'd never done that, and I had. So I found, you know, you build a lot of relationships that way. But sort of having that almost a matrix of support, so people on both sides, that people that are in your office that are very supportive, but also someone that's home, was very useful for me.
So Blaine, having been in the US and India, so do you think there's a cultural difference in the support system there and here?
So I guess for one thing, in the U.S., I think maybe we're a little bit further along in the path of being very accepting of things like career breaks. So one thing that came out recently, and I think it was a statistic that came out of the recent elections, was that, you know, more and more, and I can't remember the exact number, but women aren't just working in the U.S. They're the primary income earners in families now, whether they're single parents or they just, you know, they're earning more than their husbands. It's really not uncommon, and nobody even bats an eye in that scenario anymore. So that means you've got a huge segment of the population that are potentially, you know, mothers or have, you know, are in non-traditional career paths or whatever. So again, I think corporations are starting to realize they can't ignore that population. It's like supporting women in their careers is not just this nice, cute thing to do, and makes you feel good. It actually, if you don't do that, you're going to lose your talent, and it's a significant part of your talent. And companies that are known for treating women well are recognized, and people know that, and they look for those companies, and that almost becomes a word of mouth thing. You know, when I was going back from maternity leave, my obstetrician asked, you know, well, how long are you taking off for, you know, after the baby? And I said, well, I get 4 months paid, and I might add to that on top of that. And her jaw just dropped. Like, that was just so unheard of in the U.S. And so, you know, she's like, really, where do you work? Because I want to tell all of my patients that there are companies out there that are very supportive. So that's good. So I think in the U.S. maybe we're a little bit further advanced on the sort of the formal acceptance of this. So I've heard anecdotally, different people in India, I think, have different stories, and I think it just depends on their own family situation. And I don't think I'm in a great position to comment on all of the cultural influences in India. But I do feel like what I hear at the from people, other women at the office, it feels like we're not quite there here as much as we are in the U.S. But I think there's also a lot of progress.
Quite a lot changes when you take a break and come back to work. So in addition to qualifying technically, one needs to be adapted emotionally and get along with the new flow. So having done some research on emotional well-being, what are your thoughts on this, Vijay?
This is independent of career breaks. The self-belief and contentment is something that is an ideal, but it's very necessary. It's not only for career breaks. Every one of us needs to be content with whatever we have. And yeah, that doesn't mean we are not ambitious. How do we train emotionally after we come back? I feel the most important quality is patience. If I'm going to expect that I will just join and I will be part of all the committees in my department from day one, I'll be given the responsibilities that I had earlier, that may not happen, which is very natural. That patience and acceptance needs to be there in the initial phase. That's the most important quality that I think.
So from the study, we interestingly Sruthi, see that.
Yeah, I just remembered. So usually we compare. So I have a colleague who's on a maternity leave right now. So she mails me saying, I'm coming next week. I haven't published any papers in the past 1 year. You guys must have published so many. I have so much catching up to do. This comparison also is a big issue that we need to handle.
So one must have that acceptance to such a situation instead of just comparing against one and, you know, feeling negative about it. So from the study, we find that the preferred style to come back is not part-time, it's not work from home, but the most preferred one is full-time with flexi hours. So it's a very interesting result. So what are your thoughts on this and about maintaining work-life balance?
So was that question for anyone? So what I think is interesting about this is not the full-time working with flexible hours, because frankly, I think if you took a poll of the entire population and said, would you rather work full-time or full-time with flexible hours, most people would say full-time with flexible hours. But it's that more people said they'd rather have some sort of full-time arrangement than people that wanted to work part-time, which I think, to me, the message there is people, if you want to work full-time, I think most people want that and are looking for that much engagement and that much time, less than the flexible hours part.
Right. That's a very interesting point. It depends on the situation of individuals, but definitely here it shows that, there are a lot of them who would like to come back full-time. I've also seen in my organization, people who get back, and of course, I have my own team members reporting into me, would like to come back full-time, but would like to get that option of working, let's say, 3 hours. I would like to leave a little early. Given the Bangalore's traffic, it's an additional couple of hours, definitely. They would like to leave a little early, but continue from home those 3 hours.
Which holds even for normal employees, given the Bangalore's traffic.
Right, absolutely. I think, everybody else as well would love to work just 5 hours and, take that 3 hours and journey along with it. Which is also to kind of, talk about the point that Vijay came up with, is to catch up faster as to what I lost. And that's what I have seen as a trend. I really want to get back full time, catch up faster and get there. But one word of caution is to be conscious about what you're entering into and accept and make accordingly, whatever arrangements that you need to do. And that's extremely important. I've also seen people who kind of go behind their passion generally get back and do not take a longer break. Because, if you're not doing something which you're passionate about, it's just that moment, any given pressure, you will give way to that pressure and just go off that point. So it's important to kind of stay with your passion so that you're able to continue with it and get back full-fledged as well.
So the forum is now open for Q&A. Questions, anyone?
Hi, my name is Rashmi. I'm from Yahoo. So one thing I heard was, stay relevant through your break, which I think is excellent advice. But I have two children and I felt like I had 30 hours of work just with them when I was on maternity leave. I didn't even take a break. So I'm wondering, how did you find the time for it? And the other question is, when you take a break, like I know even the days when I say I'm working from home, everybody thinks I'm available, right? You're available. My mom will say, you know, there's a puja here, come for 5 minutes. Somebody else will say something else. The doorbell will ring 100 times. How do you do it? I'd love to learn.
Can I say one point on that? Because that is so true. I tell my husband I'm working from home, and his response is, oh, great, so you can do all these things. I'm like, no. The important part of that phrase is it's working. I'm working from home. Anyway, I'm sorry. What were you
No, saying? I think absolutely. You know, that's bang on. I prefer to work from office than from home. If not my family, who will understand? You know, fortunately, I have a family who will understand, and kind of kids will run around, do whatever they want to, but you find your own office space within that. But the maids, the people who come and knock your door, that's non-stop, right? To your first question, I think I kind of want to dwell a little more there. You know, 2 points. One is, what is important is, as mothers, we always have this feeling that we want to give full-time attention as we are taking this break. Extremely important to be a little selfish there and have your own personal time. Come what may, that's my time. That's an hour that I'm going to spend on whatever I need to. And prepare for that, you know, everybody around you. And again, that goes back to the same point that you kind of have your maid trained. You're going to tell very clearly, 2 hours, mama is out. 2 hours, tell your maid that you're going to handle. And 2 hours is okay. I mean, getting a feeling, I think the guilt is the most important thing that I see that most of us suffer. Oh my God, I'm going, you know, to this conference. Couple of hours, can I be with my kid? Oh my God, I'm going to the parlor, couple of hours, is that not fair? Is that not unfair? I think you kind of have to set your own expectations and give yourself compulsorily that couple of hours if you want to stay relevant, if you want to follow your passion. I think it's a matter of you definitely pushing yourself to that edge and kind of telling and setting the expectation around you as well, whether it's your family, whether it's your maid or anybody else, this 2 hours or 1 hour, I'm not there. And you could choose the time of the day that you want to do that, right? You could, it could be a time when your maids are available. It could be a time when your husband is available. It's a time that your mother-in-law is okay to accept that responsibility. But extremely important to plan that and take that out, I would think.
I just want to, you know, sort of add to that. When we see a lot of women who've taken that break and, you know, they are now going through that phase where they are looking at what do they need to do in that break before they make. And in many cases, it's a planned break. They say that I want to take these 2 years off, be with my children, and then come back. But during those 2 years, I need to do something in order to stay relevant or current. One of the things I find about women, and this holds good not only when they are in the break, but when they are coming back into the workplace also, is they are never in the now. They are never in the now. And this is something that I constantly, you know, whenever we run workshops, whenever we talk to women, I constantly, you know, counsel them on this. What happens is women tend to move, you know, back and forth in periods of time. So you are never fully present when you're with your children. You're never fully present when you're at the office. You're never fully present when you're giving time for yourselves. You're never fully present when you're doing that networking. You're constantly somewhere else in some point of time. I often, you know, urge women to read this book called The Power of Now by Eckhart Tolle. And he speaks so beautifully in such simple, lucid, you know, language and style about how by doing a few very simple things, you can completely come into the now zone. And when you come into the now zone, then what you're able to do is you're able to fully focus on what you want to do at that point of time. And everything else becomes irrelevant. And I think whether you want to upskill yourself or stay relevant or, you know, do something that you want to do effectively, I think this power of now is very important.
Thank you very much.
Any other questions? Anyone else? So, Saundarya, I had this question to you. This is on the earlier session. We were talking about the associates and the advocates. So, you said advocates are the one whom trust you and who will vouch for you, speak for you. But the problem here is not all of them speak up. A lot of them trust you, but not all of them speak up for you. So how do you go that extra mile and make people talk for you?
It's about choosing your advocates, really. So I guess, you know, among the people that you actually identify as the ones who you want to convert into your advocates, there would be a few people who will trust you and who, you know, in probably not in large rooms or in places, they would still vouch for you. But there would be a group who you know can be called upon to do that vouching for you. It's simply, you know, like a LinkedIn recommendation. So you have LinkedIn and you have people who give you recos. So you might have worked with somebody, you know, for a long time, but you would ask them for a recommendation, they would hesitate. Is that a good advocate? I wouldn't think so. They would probably trust you and all of that, but are they ready to really go up there and actually put it down on writing? So I think it also depends upon how you choose that combination of associates, acquaintances, advocates, and allies. And when you've chosen the right advocate, and you know, it could be somebody that you've never really interacted so much with, but that's just the power of nine. You will have to earmark in your calendar where you can, you know, go ahead and interact with them. It's a two-way street. So you would be ending up helping them as well. And you would then expect that, you know, they speak about you, and you would know that they have done it for others. So they would do it for you. And when that becomes a practice, and when repeatedly, both personally and professionally, you have proven yourself time and again, that's when they become an ally. So an ally is never only someone who's professionally related to you. An ally is someone who's also very personally invested in you. So
questions here?
Hello, I'm Jayabharti from Cisco Systems. So I have one question. So how career breaks affect your promotions in your company?
Okay, so you're talking about a sabbatical, right? Which means in your own organization, you go on a sabbatical and you come back. That's the kind of break you're talking about, right? Now, in many, many discerning organizations, that is organizations which are far thinking and which have a very clear gender balance policy in place, the sabbatical would be meaningless. It would be irrelevant. Your promotion, your growth, everything would proceed exactly as it were if you were in, you know, at work. But that also depends upon the length of the sabbatical. Let's say it's 3 months, 6 months, and you've stayed in touch and you know what's happening and you've never really lost out on something, you know, and you've been in touch with your team, the sabbatical should completely not mean anything at all. But in some other organizations where, you know, we are known to have seen that when you've taken a break and you're probably not there when a critical project was run, then you do tend to, you know, sort of people start questioning your priorities. Now, this is very, very important, and this is a point I'd definitely like to make. Now, the career world, okay, the world of business and commerce. Obviously, every organization wants women who are career primary. They want people who are career primary. If you were to devote 24 hours to your organization, 365 days a year, your organization is bound to be extraordinarily thrilled with you. That's the kind of profile of people they want. But that's not the reality. The reality is that you're likely to take breaks. You obviously want time out. You want to, you know, probably juggle a few other things. So when such kinds of things happen, organizations have to prioritize. So who will they prioritize on? Would they give a promotion to someone who has time and again gone there and actually delivered every time and been there and prioritized on the career? Or will they give the promotion to someone who has also, you know, sort of looked after family or something else or a hobby and come? So from an organization's point of view, it's about how much equity have you built within the system. And we have to be realistic about this, because the company is there not to provide, you know, work-life balance to employees. The company is there to deliver results to stakeholders. The company is there to make a profit. The company is there in order to, you know, create history with regard to the whole, you know, business. So with that perspective, obviously it is essential that they look for people who are giving, you know, 200% or 300% of their time and effort to the company. So I think women have to be very realistic about it. So if you have taken a break, then you, when you come back, you can't say, you know, how can I not get that if somebody else has been giving it, you know, their all. So I think that realism must be there in the minds of the woman professional, especially when you are in an organization where these things count, where these things make a difference.
Absolutely. I just want to add a small perspective to that. You know, extremely important to understand, as she rightly said, at what is the length of your career break that you're taking and what happens in the organization at that point in time. My own personal example, when I took, you know, a small break for my second kid, that was a time they did say that there's going to be an opportunity to move me up, but I had to take that break. But they obviously could not have waited for me to get back in 9 months, 1 year period. They had to go ahead and hire somebody. Fair enough. I think women as well have to accept that, yes, it is a reality that career breaks are will happen. And it's okay in a span of 35 years of career to forego this 9 month or 1 month promotion or 1 year promotion. It's okay. I think that acceptance, if it comes in, you will have expectations set in very well and you'll be much more satisfied of what you do.
Yeah, I think the one thing I would add to that also, Yeah, I think that's a really good point, especially when it's a planned break and you've been very organized about it and you've put a lot of thought into it. In the span of a career, it's a blip, right? I mean, it's barely something you would think about when you look back. But I also want to say, you know, to your question about promotions, I think it really, and I think this is obviously going to vary from company to company, but I think it really just, it's all about the impact that you have when you're there. And if your managers know that that's the impact you're having, that won't even matter. You know, I actually was promoted to vice president when I was 8 months pregnant. I know many women that had a similar situation. One of the, you know, Goldman just announced their managing director class for this year. One of those people is on maternity leave right now, and she was promoted to managing director while she's on leave. So it really has nothing to do with the fact that you've taken a break. It's really about the impact that you've had and the track record that you've shown while you're in the office. So
one last question there.
Hi, this is Lakshmi from Cisco. So I had a question on, like, say you're at a job interview and you have taken a break of, say, 2-3 years, and you feel that the interviewer is kind of looking down upon you because you had taken a break. So how do you confront in a situation? And typical question that comes up is, like, you know, I mean, age-wise, say you had been connected with the industry, you would have had 10 years experience. But say, because of your break, you would be rated on par with a 5-year experienced person. So there might be questions like, are you okay to work with juniors, and how would you feel in an environment? So how do you position yourself best in such a scenario?
It's a sad but true reality, Lakshmi. It happens time and again when women who have taken a break go for that interview, you know, which itself is a big deal. Out of every, there is research to say that out of every 10, applications that a woman on a break actually sends out, she gets called only for 2 organizations. She gets shortlisted only 20% of the time. So it's very difficult. I mean, you have to really position that candidate in a right way, if in case the organization has to view her as an individual and not just focus on the break. Now, what typically happens is recruiters will get lost in that mire of your break. They will never move out of it. The discussion will always be about the break. We, in fact, jokingly call it the break interview. It's not a skills interview. They will only go back and again, why did you take the break? How long was it? What did you do during the break? How could you have avoided the break? How long was it? Why was it so long? So, I mean, you really cannot help it. This is the situation right now. Unless you have a compelling story to say, unless you have stayed in touch with your craft, you know, your passion, your area of expertise, and you're able to really come back, you know, and bring the recruiter back to that discussion about what you have, you know, the skills that you possess, it'll be a break interview and it'll end with that. This is what our experience shows. And coming back to your second question about, you know, what do you do when somebody pegs you at 5 levels lower or 2 levels lower? and you know doesn't look at you on par with your peers, that again is a reality that happens. So I have known women who have taken breaks, who went to interviews and who were asked to take positions 2-3 positions lower than what they thought they deserved. They just walked out. They said, I don't think I'm going to sell myself cheap like this. I don't think, you know, I deserve to be pegged at such a lower level. I am worthy of this, so I will wait. So it's a tough call. I mean, the decision to wait may be right, may be wrong. Maybe you should have actually gone back and taken that position 2 levels lower and actually proved that you can come and, you know, become on par with somebody your age or your level. Yeah? But there have been women who have boldly said, no, I'd rather stay at home and then wait for the next good opportunity to come up than accept a position which I instinctively feel is much lower than my due. So at this point of time, there is not much scientific data around what would be the right approach. So what we're doing is we are educating the organization, and we are actually telling the organization that the organization needs women more than the women need it. That is the truth, you know, with regard to India's own huge gaping skill gap that, you know, we find. So when second career women can be a solution to the talent, organizations need to be much, much more responsive and sensitive. So that's the scenario. Harsh reality, but that's the truth today.
So it's to more of summarize a the session. Cultural change that needs to come in the company.
Sorry, I didn't hear that.
No, it's more like, you know, it's not within our rims of control to bring in that change. It has to slowly
Correct.
Creep
but
in.
The woman also can, like I mentioned, if you have really stayed on, I mean, if the woman who has taken a break has really stayed on with her craft, has managed to show passion in what she does, and she brings it forward during the interview, and she brings the recruiter to that discussion, then there is a chance that she doesn't, you know, she probably doesn't go down that route. But yes, learning has to happen on both sides of the table. Yeah.
Thank
you. So to wrap up and summarize, once a woman technologist has taken a break, the impediments to her returning to her career are many, including the obsolescence of her skills, lack of confidence, or landing in a suitable role. So times have changed. Things definitely have to change for good. So we women have to overcome such career speed breakers by building our own self-confidence, mastering the arts of negotiation, networking, and communication skills. So hope you all had a beneficial session. Here's wishing you good luck in your career on behalf of all our panelists here. Thank you.